content X is open, B itself, and so on. So all the conditions are. So here, if you do that little thing, which is not a trick, which is a good method. Well, every trick in mathematics after a few years becomes a method. Yeah. No, please. No flash. And then you get the fact that this map, are you continuing? This map is continuous. Now when you have a topological vector space of reasonable kind, when the identity map is continuous, it means a space of finite dimension. The identity map is continuous, essentially in dimension. At least some noise is getting out. Do you hear me better this way? Yes. Good. Thanks. Okay. So this is the way one proves this dimension, and you can see that it reflects the point of view of construction. So let me go a bit further and go to the introduction of sheaf cohomology. In sheaf cohomology, the difference with cohomology before was that the emphasis now is more and more on the coefficients. That is, in the old theory, coefficients not just R or C or Z, but now they are going to be a sheaf, and recall roughly what is a sheaf. A sheaf means that for every U in X open, you associate some group of vector space or something F of U with obvious axioms on restrictions. That is what is a sheaf, and one defines the common D of any space. And I think it was in Gartin's seminar, or I should say that the sheaf cohomology was essentially invented by Lorentz. Lorry was a prisoner of war, and there was a little university in the camp where he was, and he took this occasion to invent sheaf cohomology. Well, not everybody in the camp does that, but and then Cartan modified it a little bit, but I think in Lorry. But in the Cartan seminar, around 1951, about. Cartan used it in a case which Lorry had not thought at all, and nobody else had thought, which is now very familiar to many of you. That is, when X is a complex manifold, you define the sheaf of holomorphic functions by saying that the set subways, because this is also H0 of U and F, by definition of H0. Then define the sheaf of function in obvious ways, that means H0 of U and O in all the holomorphic functions of U. Then you have the higher HI. And Cartan proved rather strong, well, very strong in fact, theorem, which is that if X is what sort of time manifold, which I don't want to define define precisely, but for instance, Cn is such a thing, and if y in Cn is closed, and of course analytic, then it is also a star. And then Cartan proved that it is a so-called theorem B, because there is a theorem A. But a theorem, I state only a theorem B. X composite is equal to 4 of I. And more generally, you can replace O by any shift F with a rather technical condition, which is called coherence. Well, that technical condition is not very difficult to define really. It means that locally, the shift F is a quotient of that type. That is, locally it is a finite presentation. That is not the original definition, but it is a reasonable. We prove that. And it is extremely strong existence for various questions. For instance, I started beginning by telling you an extension problem. In this case, there is no problem at all. You have a y in x analytic and closed. In a homomorphic function on y extends because you write a little exact sequence that means looks like zero, OX goes to OY, locally there is no problem at all, then you have a kernel which is ideal, depending on Y, and your obstruction lies in H0 at 1, or X in Y, which is zero by Cartan theorem. So see, that is a perfect example of cohomology used as obstruction and being interesting when it is zero. Or I should say that cohomology has some characteristics which are not so nice. And some people don't like it. One of the reasons is that theorems like that are not effective at all. If you give yourself a function of y and you know how it goes to infinity, for instance, the theorem does not tell you that you can extend it by something which grows in a reasonable way. That's a different game. Also, we will see later another objection, so to speak, to cohomology, at least psychologically. Well, maybe I say it immediately. I have not defined which is a cohomology of the shift. The fact is that it is not very satisfactory, really. I mean, it involves some rather artificial construction. If you have a space X and a shift A, you know certainly for every resonant shift what is H0 vector A. In fact, it is built in the definition of A that you have to know what that is. So you could present the definition in the following way. Suppose you embed A into some other shift A prime. Sorry, I think I want the opposite. Let me change the letter. Then you expect you will have, and I don't find this space. But you will have a cohomology like that. Like that's a kind of cohomology. Now you choose B, you choose such elementary nesting sheaf, so that clearly that sheaf doesn't have a right of any cohomology except zero. And you choose very stupid B so that you are sure that this should be zero by definition, or you have to be. In that case, you receive a definition of H1 of A, because you define in that case. H1 of A as a co-kernel of H0 of B goes to H0 of C. Yes. Okay, so we have to choose a B, a very stupid B. For instance, if A is a sheaf of holomorphic functions on space, you're going to take for B, not completely stupid, you take all the continuous functions. That should have zero homology. But in fact, the general recipe for sheaves is worse than that. You take on B all the functions, continuous or not, on X, with other polynomial. So you have a definition, but it's very difficult to use, and homology is never computed by going back to that definition. And I think that is psychologically an obstacle for many mathematicians who like concrete definitions with objects they can handle. No, in cohomology, very often, the definitions cannot be used stupid and directly. You have to wait until you have developed quite a lot of properties, and then at the end, you compute. So it's a different game than classical analysis, for instance. And that's going worse and worse with the years. I mean, when we go to Grothendieck, it will be even more like that. Because I think I will say very little on the next stage. We're still in 51, essentially. But around that stage, the Zariski topology. Began to be used, so you know what that is. It means the closed sets in an algebraic variety are the algebraic subsets. And that means the open sets are either very small, an empty set, or extremely large. For instance, when you have a curve, the only open sets are the empty set and the curve minus finite number of points. And the classical topologist is very skeptical when he sees such a space. I mean, it looks terrible, especially the algebraic structure has disappeared. You have a set, and you define the open set as an empty set, and the set minus finite number of points. What can you get? The fact that you can get something for that is that when the years went by, it became clear that when you work with cohomology, what is important is F. It's not X. And at the end, or not the end, in the 60s or 70s, the Grothendieck had a theory of topos in which X disappears. There is no X. You just have the category of the sheaves with some structure on them, but the points do not play any role. And already, for those of you who know schemes, the definition of a scheme by points is not so natural. It's a bit arbitrary. So the Zariski topology looks strange, but because of the sheaf, it will give us something. At first, it was introduced by Zariski as a convenient language. But no one was taking it very seriously. I think the first work where it was used, the different way was where some dots are on the way. On algebraic fiber spaces, the date of that, I think, is about shortly. They were not published, but they were typed and they were reproduced. They were given in Chicago lectures. And they showed how you can define fiber spaces like in topology by taking the products. When you have a group G and you take more than set U, you take G cross U, and then you have a new prime, and then you bring them together, the intersection, just like the topologies we do. So you have a definition of locally trivial fiber spaces. And they had the same idea for complex analysis. He also introduced complex analytic fiber rings. And Carton gave an exposition of that in the International Congress in 1950. So that was the date of those 50. And they showed that if you look at the cohomogene, if you look at fiber spaces analytic with the additive group or the multiplicative group, they give you an interpretation of the so-called cousins problems. In analytic geometry, that is constructing functions with poles given, like I started with, but several dimensional, and multiplicative cosine problem, you give you the divisor of the function. So it showed that, and that was, I think, the first case where Zariski topology was used as a honest topology. Soon after that, the theory of coherent algebraic sheaves was invented. That was not very difficult to do, and it was shown that the cohomology, the Zariski topology, is very well adapted to coherent sheaves. But that is not the topic of the day, because it was really something easy. It was something easy, and it was not exactly where it was. Well, coherent sheaves, that's perfectly all right for studying linear series of divisors. And every problem which is linear, so to speak. Linear problems. But it was not enough to do what was suggested by various conjectures. So that was one motivation, and second motivation was fiber spaces. Because they, I told you, have defined them not linearly, but they are locally trivial, they are locally product. Now, when you work with Lie groups, say real Lie groups, for instance, you have a real Lie group G and you have a closed. Then you want to say that this fiber ring is locally trivial. And it is indeed easy to show. You have your group G, you have a fiber, you want to show that it is locally trivial. What you need is to write a neighborhood as a product. You choose any point there. You choose any little piece transversal to it. And that's it. That's the goal. So this work in the topology, in the differential setting, in the complex analytic setting, in the real analytic setting, but not in the algebraic setting. Even if you take G and H to be connected, I think I was interested in, well, I was not the only one to be interested in Guattani, Chevalet, myself, we were interested in a special case where G is connected and H is also connected. And why it doesn't work? It's because it's algebraic geometry, because the things exist are very large. So that if you try to do the image here, your H, the G over H is not easy to define, but there is not much problem. But if you have such, I should not draw it that way, I should draw it with G and H, and then that is a quotient geometry. You're tempted to take little bits. But in algebraic geometry, there is no little bits. Little bits ask to be extended. And because it's algebraic. And then when you extend it, usually it goes back. So that you're not getting really a local decomposition. So I gave a lecture on that. This is convergent. Even over the complex numbers, there is no local cross-section, algebraic. Because before that, I think Chevalet, Grothendieck had a tendency to believe that it would always work. No, it doesn't work. And in the Chevalet seminar, I explained that after all, you can just say that you're going to be interested in triangles. Which become trivial after you have made a change like that. So instead of locally trivial, they are, I call them locally isotrivial, but the terminology did not stick. And also my technical definition was not the best possible. But in any case, what I showed in that lecture is that if you do that, you have an excellent H1. You have really the property that you want. And Grothendieck was at the lecture, and immediately at the end he told me, sir, this is going to give us the cohomology we need for the main conjectures. And in the International Congress of the same year, he said the same. He said, this is going to give us what we want. Now, there is no problem in defining cohomology to HR. You just copy more or less what you do with ordinary open sets. But in ordinary open sets, you restrict to U, where U is open, and it's, this is an immersion, an embedding, open embedding. In the entire topology, you just replace that by a U, and then you ask, does this be a finite office, which is Italian, as a point of interest, so Italian. So you embedding, no. Italian, yes. And that's all the difference. Of course, those things are not easy to compute. And Rodendick introduced that for 58, and nothing at all happened for at least 3 years. Which is, when you were young, and 3 years when you were young is a long time. So, until 61, my guardian, 1961, 63, I think, my guardian started a seminar at Harvard. See, the notes were published by MIT, in which he looked at Italian cosmology and he started proving basic theorems on that. In particular, he computed a few non-obvious cosmologicals. So he starts, that was the start. Then, in well, around 64, 65, then Grothendieck and my guardian, and Perrier, they made a very systematic seminar where they proved particularly all the functorial properties which are needed. And some of them are not easy. Deligne, in an interview, has explained how surprised he was by one of the proofs. There was one of the main statements, I forgot which one, which doesn't look easy, but Grothendieck reduced it by a series of little manipulations to cases, simpler and simpler, and at the end there was nothing, so to speak. There was no effort, which was the technique of Grothendieck in general, to dissolve the thing. But what was not obvious at all, and was not proved yet, was that it could be used for the very conjectures. Now, I have to recall that. Because the very conjectures played, in fact, the main role for the invention of Italian cosmology. I noticed in a paper around 1949, if I remember correctly, he had noticed the following. That suppose we have a variety X now over the finite field. And you want to count the poles of X over F cubed. You want to estimate, as you know, that's a very interesting question, estimate the size, the number of elements. Then you view X of F cubed as a number of fixed points of the Frobenius map acting, there is a little abuse here, I mean acting on F Q bar, an algebraic closure into itself. Because that's what it is. The rational point is a point which is fixed by Frobenius. But then, the idea of very well that you should view this as a topological space, and you should use the so-called fixed point formula, which has a long history, which I don't want to know, but the fixed point formula is that this number is an alternating sum of the traces of the Frobenius acting on the cohomology. Now, cohomology, first it has to be the cohomology of over the algebraic closure, so it's like that. And with what?